включил?
Excellent.
Okay, guys, I think we can start our conversation about transpersonal project, so-called, or spiritually oriented humanitarian sites, its mistakes, and also its connection with world spiritual movement, so to say, spiritual tradition, especially the Tibetan one.
Okay.
Yeah? And let me introduce myself and other participants of this conversations. I am Vladimir Maikov, founding president of Russian Association of Transpersonal Psychology and Psychotherapy, and I am in the field spiritually oriented humanitarian sciences for the last 35 years. And let me introduce two of my friends, my Russian-German colleague, famous Russian philosopher, Mikhail Ryklin, and also my Venezuelan colleague, both in Dzogchen community, my spiritual brother, and colleague in world transpersonal community, Elias Capriles, who is professor of Caracas University, and who recently published his four-volume masterpiece, Beyond Mind. Beyond, where he analyze and bring new light from Dzogchen perspective on most important schools of world transpersonal psychology, I would say. So, Elias, first question to you. What was driving force behind writing these books? How it started, how it happens?
Well, when I was for many years doing retreat, Dzogchen retreat in the Himalayas, and when I came back, I wanted to communicate that in the language of philosophy and
what
psychology.
Year? When it happened?
I went back to Venezuela in 1983.
83, so before that you studied in Himalayas with Tibetan masters, yeah?
No. I came back on 83.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I stayed for some years in retreat, and I was studying under Dujun Rinpoche, Tilme Norbu Rinpoche, Dilgo Chenzer, and I met Chogyal Namke Norbu there also.
Uh-huh. But before you already was a student of famous Dzogchen masters.
No.
Before meeting Chogyal Namkhe Norbu.
I met Chogyal Namkhe Norbu after I was already practicing on there.
Yeah.
But that was in 78.
Mm-hmm.
And then I came back to Venezuela in 83.
Mm-hmm.
And then I wanted to I mean, the only thing that I thought was worthwhile was to communicate what I was doing, and that which was transforming me somehow. And of course, I couldn't assume the role of a teacher because I wasn't a teacher. That would be like an unauthentic thing, and I just wouldn't do it. So I was offered a series of lectures in the university on Buddhism and Western philosophy and psychology and so on. And I didn't take them. I mean, I just let time pass until I got a letter from an ex-girlfriend who said Chogyal Namkhe Norbu would go to Venezuela if there was a group formed.
Mm-hmm.
And then I ran to the university and I said, I want to give these lectures now. It was a week, and we did three series, and we invited Chogyal Namkhe Norbu. And in these three series of lectures, I did more or less the same I'm doing now, but in a more general, that was one lecture was on ontology, another one on philosophy of history, another one on psychology. It was like different.
Were you a philosopher or psychologist at this time?
I was studying philosophy, but some Spanish philosopher came to the university and he gave a lecture, and then I was in the public and I began to talk to him, and then he said, "No, this can. It's impossible that we discuss all this here. You should come and give some lecture here." And then I was invited to give this lecture. Yeah.
So. And how your connection with transpersonal field started, and when?
Because I was very much connected with anti-psychiatry. I have been reading about that.
Cooper Lang, you mean?
Yeah, and other ones, including David Cooper, who lived in Paris also, connected also to Deleuze and Guattari and many of these people in the anti-psychiatric movement. And then when I came back, I discovered that this transpersonal psychology had developed, and I began to read on that. But then I discovered that, though it seemed to be the same I wanted to do, it was what each one was doing was different in a different way from what I thought a real transpersonal psychology should be.
So after reading books by Wilbur, Grof, Washburn, etc., some other people, you started to understand that your direction is different from this. It was in the middle of 80th already.
I began reading them in that time, but I didn't devote so much time to the study of this because I was doing many things at the time. I was also doing a philosophy of history and philosophy, political philosophy. And when I finished with that, then I got more into, because I couldn't do everything at the same time. And then I, the more I studied these people, the more I realized where the key differences lied. So I began to feel the need to really write on this. Then the first thing I wrote was in Spanish. And then I prepared something in English for the International Journal of Transpersonal Studies, which at the time was in Hawaii. And
your first paper for this journal, yeah?
And then some people liked that paper, and I felt the need to go further into it, deeper into it, because I was reading more and more. And then the more I read, the more somehow my line developed.
As far as I know, there are several versions of your books, kind of Caprilius 1, Caprilius 2, Caprilius 3, and now published Caprilius more or less up to date. What was the difference? What was the line of your developing of your vision, so to say?
I don't think it's like so much like that there is a difference. It's just that it became more elaborate.
More elaborate.
Somehow, yeah. And of course, there were some differences, maybe, but it's a little difficult to express it. Maybe I wasn't so clearly saying that human beings are, I was saying it, but I haven't developed it to such an extent that human beings are born with an innate or inborn delusion, and that, of course, it's not a way, it's not a matter of going back, of undoing what we have done as the result of our ontogeny, but that it was something much deeper than that, because we mm-hmm. are already born mm-hmm. with an inborn delusion mm-hmm. and an inborn tendency or propensity to develop other types of delusion. Yeah.
As you know, among transpersonal writers, Stanislav Grof and Ken Wilber are most famous.
Yes.
And they published each of them over 20 books, maybe. And so translated into many, many languages, especially Ken Wilber.
Yes.
He's translated over 20 languages. And in some reviews, he's considered the most well-known American intellectual. Yeah, in some. Of course, there is a lot of criticism, both against Wilber and against Grof, and each of them criticizes each other, etc., etc. And what is specific your position towards him? I presume that the main, so to say, the main point of critic is that it's done from Dzogchen vision, Dzogchen perspective, not from philosophy or not from another transpersonal school. Can you clarify?
Yes. Well, Ken Wilber, for example, he claims, I mean, he actually studied with one important Dzogchen master, Pengo mm-hmm. Rinpoche, Pema mm-hmm. Norbu Rinpoche. Mm-hmm. And he claims to be speaking from a Dzogchen perspective.
Uh-huh. Also.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That is why my criticism of Wilber is much harsher than my criticism of Grof, for example, or Washburn, because they don't claim to be speaking from a Dzogchen standpoint.
Yeah, yeah.
They have their right to say whatever they want, and they have the right to disagree. But if someone speaks...
More layman positions.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
But he is claiming to be doing, to be speaking from a Dzogchen.
Where? I don't remember. In what books or in what pieces of his books?
Oh, I think he has said that in several places, but at least in this, what is his name? All and Everything?
Ah, yeah, All and Every, the Theory of Everything.
Yeah, and the other one, which is...
Brief History of Everything.
Brief History of Everything. And mm-hmm. the other one is...
The Theory of Everything.
Yeah.
And spiritual... integral spirituality, maybe.
Yeah, no, I mean... this one is like a summary of mm-hmm. this other one, sex...
Sex, Ecology, Spirituality.
Sex,
yeah.
Sex, Ecology, Spirituality. Mm-hmm. In all of those, he already says that, and also in interviews, and of course, he also acknowledged the influence of Vedanta, but he claims that it's all the same thing. Yeah, mm-hmm. And this is very much like the view of what is called perennial philosophy. Perennial philosophy actually is a term that was coined by Leibniz. It's not... Mm-hmm. But then Aldous Huxley wrote this book, mm-hmm. The Perennial mm-hmm. Philosophy, and then people created a very vague concept of what a perennial philosophy mm-hmm. is, mm-hmm. and it's like it's all the same. And I don't agree that it's all the same. I agree that many things share a name and a practice, at least to some extent, and even perhaps a source. Actually, I believe even a source. Mm-hmm. But there are other traditions.
In one of your books, you think consider the source Kailash.
Yes, yeah? Very good.
It's the source of many traditions.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes. Yes, for example, according to, well, Giuseppe Tucci, he was the Tibetologist who brought Chogyal Namke Norbu mm-hmm. to Italy.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that Dzogchen drew from Shaivism. that the source of oxygen was HIV because many of the terms were the same. Then Chogyal Nanken Orbu says, actually, which is the abode of Shiva? Mount Kailash. Where is Mount Kailash in Tibet? And what is the etymology of those words? Is it Sanskrit or is it Tibeto-Burmese? The etymology of those words, of keywords of Shaivism, which are shared by the Dzogchen teachings, are Tibeto-Burmese. So how could Shaivism lend to Dzogchen words which are Tibeto-Burmese when Shaivism could be either Dravidian, actually the old was Dravidian Harappan, and then after the Indo-European invasions, it was Sanskrit. There is absolutely no reason for there to be those words in there, yeah?
Okay, it's an interesting point, but let's return back to the most important, the essential one, okay? So, your position and some vague point in so-called Wilbur Dzogchen background.
Yeah.
You're criticizing.
For example, in the whole of Buddhism, there is a key concept. I think it's perhaps the most important concept of Buddhism. And of course, it's shared by Dzogchen. Well, Dzogchen, there is Buddhist Dzogchen, there is Bunpo Dzogchen, but they are more or less the same. So we could say that the whole of Dzogchen, including Bun and Buddhism, share a concept which is more than a concept because it comes from experience. Is the difference between, in Sanskrit, Samskrita and Asamskrita. In Pali, Sankata and Asankata, in Tibetan, Duche and Dumache. And it's not easy to translate that. It's impossible to render it with a single word because it means Sanskrita is that which is produced, created, fabricated, intentional, contrived, conditioned, born, or compounded. So it has many acceptations, or rather, it has an acceptation that is so wide that it has to be rendered with several words. It cannot be rendered with a single word. And Asamskrita is all that is not any of those things. Then Wilbur's view, for example, Washburn calls his paradigm, he calls it the structural hierarchical. And I think it's quite a good term for describing Wilbur. Because he claims that there are basic structures and then a replacement structures and then a self and then fulcra for concept. And the basic structures, you build one and that one will remain, and then the second one will be built on that one, and the third one will be built on that one. And enlightenment is not just seen through all structures into that which was there before all structures were built, but it requires the creation of one structure. Is very much like the story of the Babel Tower in the Judaic tradition. The Babel Tower was a structure made in order to reach heaven. And that is, to me, exactly what Wilbur is doing. I mean,
it's early period, a kind of developmental model. But also in Integral Spirituality and later books, he is putting so-called Wilbur Comps, you know. He described, for example, when I was talking with him, making interview with him, he dedicated half of the talk explain of his vision of what is enlightenment in integral approach. And so equally important, both more and more non-dual states and more and more higher levels. You know, but you can also get enlightened being on shamanic level, so to say, in the same non-dual states.
Yes, this is the point. I mean, Wilber claims that you need to build a structure over a structure, yeah?
Yeah.
And then, of course, when you reach the highest structure, you have, he doesn't put it in those words, but it's like you see through all the structures. But you cannot see through all the structures until you have created that last structure. And then he has changed because after some time he began accepting, because there is both an ontogenetic and a phylogenetic interpretation. Mm-hmm. Yeah? In phylogenesis, in the phylogenetic interpretation, before he claimed that it was only very recently that people began to be able to attain what is normally rendered as enlightenment, yeah? And he also claims that children also have to develop in the process of ontogeny, they have to develop a lot of structure, and only once they have developed them can they somehow come to the point at which they have this non-dual realization that implies seeing through them, yeah? But then he accepts, yeah, that perhaps some very special people at the shamanic period, but he continues to say that enlightenment arose with the Buddha Shakyamuni at that time. According to the Dzogchen teachings, there have been Buddhas since there was humankind. Yeah, from the very beginnings of humankind, there have been Dzogchen teachings. So this is a totally different way. And ontogenetically speaking, it's also very similar because we have children. For example, there is this child who he's called Namtar. Namtar no, Nam,
you mean some Terton who manifested this capacity in
Yan? This Terton, I am having difficulty with the memory that I have those.
That doesn't matter.
Those strokes and
Yan enlightened Tibetan master, in what age? Some 5 or 8?
No, a little older, maybe he 10. Was 12, but he had. He was
Mingyur
Dorje, exactly. actually, I don't remember exactly the age at which he had his first awakening, but maybe he was 8, and yeah, I think he was 8. And when he was 12, he began to reveal termas, and then he continued to reveal termas until he was 21 and he died. Of course, 21 in Tibetan terms might mean 19 or 20. Because in Tibet, when you are born, you are 1 year old because that's your first year of life. And if the new year is 3 days after, when you are 4 days old, you are 2 years old. So this is difficult to calculate, we don't know. Anyhow, this absolutely destroys the view of Wilber, And there are many other cases, a small child who was very bolsterous and some.
But it's not only Wilber view, it's a kind of general Western vision, hierarchical gradual path, Jacob ladder, so to say. And if we look on the idea of evolution, human development in Western culture, it's connected with higher skills, champions, masters, stars in different fields. So great achievements of something. It's idea of perfection in Western, gradual, and every culture is supporting this vision. But so there is Eastern perspective. We can be instantly enlightened at any age. There is no limits for everything, and no time space limits. So it wasn't Shakyamuni Buddha who was first enlightened Buddhist teacher long before them, lineage of Dzogchen masters, etc., etc., etc. We don't know whether it's true or not.
Exactly.
No other historical proof, but it's connected with Dzogchen vision. Anyway, it's and supports them. And I think that Wilber made an attempt to unite both perspectives. He is trying to get best from Western. He can't reject from Western worlds, since and we can't reject. We are part of Western world. And so we can criticize not gradual vision, but limits of, I think, these visions. And we can look for the way how we can improve this vision with infinite perspectives, through infinite perspectives of Dzogchen or something else. Since everything in Western culture is based on mind,
yeah,
and function of mind, and subtle differences in every field. What do you think, Mikhail? Is it possible to eliminate gradual perspective from Western culture? Or criticizes it's wrong, for example, philosophy is wrong since it's based on mind?
It would be difficult because the Western system of education is so constructed that you should first, you should progress degree by degree. It's a very old tradition, so it would be hard. It's not easy to destroy this system, because, say, we take Germany, you have this Abitur, it means it's more than middle school. Then you should go into the university, have your university grade, then the first dissertation, then the second dissertation. The second dissertation means you have a right to be a professor.
Mm-hmm. You're now doctor, PhD,
you're PhD, so this gradual system is sort of rooted in the structure of Western institutions. If you are 17, you come to the university and you say, I am enlightened. Well, fine, you are enlightened, good. But it does not change anything. You should begin studying in the university. You should make your dissertation. You should do the so enlightened or not. So,
what do you think? What is the weak point of this gradual vision? And why do you think that Wilber is too much attached to that perspective?
Yeah, but I want to emphasize the point of Sanskrit and Asanskrit, and then we come back to that,
okay,
because this is the key for understanding the difference. All that is Sanskrit has a beginning and has an end, depends on causes and conditions, or it is interdependently arisen. It arises interdependently or co-emergently, or however you want to translate that. Yeah. Then it has a beginning, it has an end. It cannot be a definitive solution to the problem of life. So I think this is a very important point, yeah? Because if so long as we believe that we have to build a structure after a structure, and those structures have to remain, even if at some point we reach the non-dual, that involves that we are no longer conditioned by all the structures, the idea is that the structure has to remain. I think that is, and also Wilber doesn't say quite clearly whether this is or is not, there is or there isn't a real scene through all the structures. We will come back to that later on. Mm-hmm. Now, in Tibet, they also had this system of education. Of course, there were some people who could be, they were recognized as tulkus or something like that, or maybe even they weren't recognized as anything, and they just, at some point, they begin to shine, and they were recognized universally as being great masters. But there is also the gradual system, yeah? And nonetheless, the view of the philosophy of history is degenerative. Yeah, is a golden age, which is called the Kritya Yuga, the era of truth, or the Satya Yuga, the age of, Kritya is perfection and Satya is truth. And then there is a degeneration, which is produced by the development of avidya, delusion. Yeah? The more we evolve, the more delusion there is. And this is the absolute opposite of Hegel's view, for example, which I think has conditioned Wilber, and Washburn is also very clearly conditioned by, by Hegel. And of course, Hegel, he was an idealist. He believed the world was a projection of idea or spirit. In different works, he used different terms. But it was something that was non-material, and the material world was a projection of that, yeah? And therefore, the material world had to develop in the same way, because it was a projection, as the idea developed, yeah? And he believed in progress, in everything getting better all the time. So, if everything arose dialectically, yeah, then and each position begot a counterposition, or each, that is actually the Hegelian term. Sometimes we say thesis and antithesis, but it's more position and counterposition, and then unification is more the right terminology in Hegel. And if everything is progressing, and the world and society and the human mind and everything, yeah, develops in terms of the rules of the development of the idea, and there is progress, then there must be somehow a kind of negation that incorporates that which is negated, and which begets something that is more perfect and more complete than what there was before. And I think this is a very important point, yeah, because it has conditioned a lot of Western thinking, at the same time as it is a result of a conception of evolution as progress that already existed and that was part of the Enlightenment and the whole project of modernity. But then that negation that incorporates the negated and that produces something that is more complete, I haven't found it anywhere. I have given in my books several examples because some people say you can use relativity theory to as an example of that. I've shown this is impossible. And in general, I have looked to all the examples that people give of this, and I've never found that, yeah? I think the negation that incorporates the negator is what Jean-Paul Sartre called mauvais foi, bad faith, which is self-deceit, a negation in which at the same time as I negate something, I negate that I have negated something, and so on ad infinitum. So that I negate without realizing that I have, well, realizing it, but forgetting immediately that I have negated anything, yeah? And what that begets is actually more deceit, more unauthenticity, more fragmentation, and I think this is what has actually been happening in evolution, in the evolution, spiritual evolution, not only of the West, but of the whole world. I have developed that also in some books which are on philosophy of history and political philosophy and so on, not so much in this Beyond Mind papers, or, but I think it's an important point because Wilber's view is very much conditioned by this Hegel view. And it's quite the opposite of the Buddhist, not only Dzogchen, but Buddhist. And also in Buddhism, we have many Buddhas before Shakyamuni, which we don't know whether they existed materially, but the, that's mm-hmm. part of the teaching. So the mm-hmm. very teaching is contrary to the way that prevails in the West, but that is not the only one, because, for example, the cynics, they taught degenerative, and supposedly we can imagine they claim that Heraclitus was their source, and Heraclitus speaks of the Aeon, and the Aeon might be the same as the Kalpa, which is degenerative, and then the Stoics drew from the cynics, because the father of the Stoia was a disciple of Crates of Tebas, who was a cynic, and but then he studied with some other philosophers who were logicians and so on, and he made something a little strange, but they kept this degenerative theory, and it also involved a social theory in which the egalitarian state was characteristic of the beginning, and that amounted to perfection. And also mm-hmm. The lack of hierarchy, which is the opposite of Wilber. For Wilber, hierarchy is the big thing, yeah? And
holoarchy. In holoarchy also.
Holoarchy, yeah, he says holoarchy. But for me, that's just hierarchy mm-hmm. in newspeak.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mikhail, do you agree with these arguments, philosophical arguments and visions? This discussion about hierarchy, Western hierarchical perspectives. Wilber inherited from Hegel and its limitations.
Well, this perspective, the Western and the Eastern one, are pretty different. It's difficult to imagine that. We know, for instance, how Roman Pope is elected. In order to vote, you should be a cardinal. In order to be a cardinal, you should previously be a bishop. In order to be a bishop, you should be a priest. So, it's a very, so, and how Dalai Lama is found, a child, say, 3 years old, or 4 years old, whether he knows, what he knows about his predecessor. They show him the things of the predecessor, and he said, this one is right, and this is wrong. So, and if he guesses everything right, he is recognized as his reincarnation. In Western perspective, it's difficult to imagine that so the Roman Pope would be elected among four-year-old mm-hmm. children. If they recognize the things of the previous Pope, they elected a Pope. So it's unimaginable in the Western perspective. In order to be allowed to vote for a pope, you should
so
have this
Western this hierarchy selected by a community of hierarchs.
Of course, it's only 30 or 40 people who have this cardinal this rank. Mm-hmm. Well, so you have to pass through many, many stages in order to be allowed to vote for a pope.
And Eastern teacher is recognized from
quite
revelation, so to say.
Two quite different perspective. So that's why I see the Western philosophy and the Eastern wisdom as two very different. They have, of course, some points where they converge, where they merge. There are such, but it's a sort of, it's very rare. One of these, for me, one of these figures is Meister Eckhart, whose perspective is very near to the Buddhist perspective. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, what he preached as a priest was very near. I don't know whether he knew something about Buddhism. It is 14th century. It's old, but as for the great European philosophers, it's another kind of game, to my mind. That's why I met Namkhai Norbu. I was 54. Before I met many philosophers, but still, what he gave was quite new for me. Although I knew philosophers like Richard Rorty, like Frederick Jameson, like Jacques Derrida, like Jean Baudrillard. Well, I had this experience already. I have made some kind of career in the philosophy, but still, as I was 54, as I came for the first time in Crimea for this retreat, and it was a new world for me. It means that philosophy has not given me this. But although
even Derrida and Baudrillard.
I worked with a very, very interesting and really inspired philosophers. Derrida was called a great philosopher, maybe the last great philosopher in the Western tradition. He was recognized as such. And I worked with Derrida for 2 years in Paris. I was kind of his assistant. And I knew also him as a person very well, his family. But I can say that it was a sort of revelation, this first retreat.
Why? Can you say why? What was revealed?
Because philosophy has to do with logos. It's more dependent on how you write, on the knowledge of your of the language. So there are a big number of preconditions in order to work as a philosopher. You have to receive an appropriate education. You have to read dozens of books, starting from pre-Socratics. We taught, as I was a student, we taught the ancient Greek and the Latin and of course the German language, which is one of the biggest philosophical languages. So you have to be prepared. But say the teacher of our teacher was somebody who was an uneducated guy. He couldn't read. Our teacher had to write down what he was dictating him, because this guy was a completely enlightened person. At the same time, he could not read. Strange, yes. Could you imagine Derrida or Deleuze? They cannot read, of course. And at the same time, they reached the perfection. But this is a difference. You have a number of diplomas. You have to read not only one language, but at least four or five languages.
Our capacity to be enlightened doesn't depend on any external circumstances. Education, age.
Yes, some of the enlightened persons were very educated, like Long Chin Pa, like our teacher. Maybe, but it also may be that this woman who was in for 50 years in a dark retreat.
Alejandro.
Yeah, I don't believe that she was very educated. Kind of a woman, yes. Of course, the philosophers like I knew, they are very much better educated. But enlightenment is something apart. It's not this. It has nothing to do with education. It's good when a person enlightened at the same time he can also explain. But say this Chanchub Dorje explained to our teacher. He explained him in an oral way what is Dzogchen, and he said he never received the more profound explanation of Dzogchen than he received from his teacher, root teacher Chanchub Dorje. But he explained him. I remember he explained that it was a big. He wanted a ritual. He wanted that he makes a ritual and a kind of. This teacher was not able to make literally proper, because our teacher was educated in a monastery, but his teacher was not educated. But he, after this ritual, he said, it is not a big deal, this ritual. I explain you. And he explained him, just in a simple Tibetan language, what it is. And he said, nobody explained him better.
So, can we explain on simple Western language the same revelations? What do you think?
I don't believe it. I say that such a big philosopher as Jacques Derrida, he had no idea about these things. No idea. He knew the
even way. Little suspicion.
Yeah. Yes.
Even little guesses.
It's quite another thing. He knew the Greek philosophy, the ancient Greek philosophy. He knew the Latin, the Roman philosophy. He knew the philosophy of the new age. Of course, he knew the German philosophy very well. He almost all French philosophers whom I spoke, they knew the German language, the English, of course, and they were inspired by Heidegger and Nietzsche. They were very much inspired by the German philosophers, Martin Heidegger and Friedrich Nietzsche, because this was a very big influence. But I guess it's my private, very limited kind of, but maybe other people here can make another kind of experience, and they have another scene and another outlook. But I see this tradition as very much different, very much different, and because that's why I can receive so much from Nankai Naobo, because it's new for me. It's new.
Elias, what do you think about this point? Is it possible to explain, to transmit the essence of Dzogchen teaching vision on Western language, simple Western language?
But before you said something, and you expressed it in one phrase, which was enlightenment does not depend. And you were saying that the Western depends a Sanskrita and Sanskrita. Mm-hmm. That's the concept that I wanted to lay out, to explain or to introduce at the beginning, because it's so determinant somehow. Yeah, I think it's of course possible to explain very simple, but no one will pay attention to you. Mm-hmm. That's why I learned philosophy and psychology, and because I want people to pay attention to me, to take me seriously. If you don't speak in that language, they will not take you seriously. So I thought, I want to say things that can be very simple, but if I just say them, you know, after, for example...
Just come to Zampo, everything is good.
Exactly. I mean, they say the real understanding is understanding on the basis of a single word. Since Hegel was told that he had to be write a little more difficult, because otherwise no one would pay attention to him. Mm-hmm. Yeah, everything has become complicated. And then we have to do the same a little bit, because otherwise no one will pay attention. Of course, that's why I began to do all this. What I wanted to say, I could have said very easily. I don't think it's necessary to go through so many complications, but, well, Rinpoche, he has his etulku, and he has a recognition and so on. So when he wants, he can explain very simply, and people will pay attention, those who are interested. But if one doesn't have those credentials, then one has to go through this... But I wanted to say something about Derrida, because it's interesting. This idea of deconstruction is very much like Nagarjuna. This is more or less what Nagarjuna was saying, but with a difference. Yeah, we could say deconstruction and destruction, and maybe Nagarjuna was destruction rather than deconstruction. I want you to say something about that, but let me first say what I... And it's that Derrida is deconstructing everything, But then he comes to this difference written with an A rather than an E.
Yes.
And he keeps that concept as something that cannot be deconstructed. Mm-hmm. So there is an angular stone, how you say, something on which everything is built. Mm-hmm. Yeah, all the differences mm-hmm. are mm-hmm. built on, because of that condition of possibility of all differences. And Nagarjuna deconstructs that as well.
Yeah.
So we come to emptiness. Mm-hmm. And what could you say about that? Because this is not only my idea. I think the first who explained this was David Loy, yes. from Zen Master.
Yes. As far as I understand, Nagarjuna is saying that every possible statement, every possible affirmation is neither right nor wrong. It is neutral. Derrida also, he deconstructs, his idea was if somebody affirms something, I try to deconstruct. I try to find possibility to show what's behind this. But Nagarjuna was a religious, a Buddhist, a Buddhist religious teacher, and it makes difference because Derrida needs theory, he needs affirmation, he may deconstruct whatever he wants, but still his deconstruction is also a kind of and Nagarjuna is more radical because he says any kind of affirmation is neither right nor wrong, neither right nor wrong. So this is his so-called the middle way, the Srediny Putin. That's his idea. Much more radical, that philosophy cannot digest this radical idea, because it means that that logos is neutralized in his roots. So logos is neutralized.
I think the attitude of Nagarjuna was to help students to reach enlightenment,
yes.
first of all,
yes.
and to eliminate obstacles,
yes.
Including mental obstacles.
Yes.
But the idea of Derrida was to clarify situation, to criticize, and to build the superiority of his vision,
uh-huh.
yes.
to support, in a sense.
Yes, the final idea was that deconstruction is right.
Yeah.
Is right.
Yeah.
Although deconstruction, he always said, deconstruction is completely contextual, dependent on context. So I talked with him in Moscow when he came for the. He said, "You should invent deconstruction. I am French of Algerian origin. I am
mm-hmm.
a Jew born in Algeria, then came to France.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
My deconstruction is a kind of my living experience. So you should not repeat me. It's impossible, it's useless. So you should invent deconstruction as a Russian,
mm-hmm.
as somebody who is much younger than me." So his idea was deconstruction depends
mm-hmm.
on the context.
Mm-hmm.
There is American deconstruction, right? But he said at the same time, there are certain rules that cannot be sacrificed.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes, of course, mm-hmm. in every context you should reinvent the construction, but certain rules you should follow. Otherwise, it is not the construction. So it's complicated. It's very complicated. So,
I think what is important about Nagarjuna's method is that the true condition of reality is continuous or analog. And thought is digital. Every thought is defined by exclusion of others in terms of the philosophy of Acharya Dignaga.
Mm-hmm.
And in the West, we said definitio fit per genus proximum,
mm-hmm.
et differentiam specificam, and so on. And that's digital, yeah? Affirmation and negation. Reality is continuous, like even in physics, field theory is that reality is continuous and our interpretation divides it, and then that it takes this division to be absolutely true.
But quantum mechanics is digital.
Sorry?
Quantum mechanics is digital. Both continuous and digital at the same time.
Yeah, but it's, I mean the
Schrödinger uncertainty.
Yeah, yeah, I understand what you are saying. When you speak of mechanics, of course, mechanics is already a digital idea. But when you speak about
quantum, huh? It's both wave and particle.
Yes.
Quantum reality.
Yes.
So both digital and so we can look at these two ways, continuous analog and digital, as two visions of reality,
yeah,
supplementing each other.
But according to field theory, no matter whether we interpret, for example, the photon or the electron as wave or particle, because it's neither, and it has the character, it behaves as either in different conditions, but the energy field is continuous. It has no spaces without energy and nothing different from the energy to divide one thing from another. So whatever divides one thing from another is thought. The thought that is involved in perception, the concept in terms of which we perceive. So when we perceive that which is continuous as being discontinuous, that's delusion. And that's avidya. So that's why Nagarjuna was trying to take... whenever people clung to something, he did like that. Like a mother to a child who clings to something. Yeah, you get this?
Yes.
You get this? No? And you get attached to this, then... Yeah? And of course that's not Derrida, because he didn't have his interest was not liberation, no? His interest was something very different. And that's why, for example, in Nagarjuna's philosophy, it is said we are deviating a little bit from the transpersonal, but we can come back to that now. Nagarjuna philosophy, it is said, for example, especially Chandrakirti, he gave continuity in the 8th century after Christ to Nagarjuna's thought. It's called, the Tibetans call Prasangika Madhyamaka. He made it very clear that, well, Nagarjuna already says whatever can be thought is false, like Nietzsche, but from a different viewpoint. Very different viewpoint, because it was soteriological. It wasn't just a theory about reality. Actually, the point was to destroy all theories about reality in order to come to the non-digital realization of the analog or in continuous true condition somehow. And that's why, according to this system, Buddha's there are two concepts, swamata and paramata. Swamata and paramata in Sanskrit. Swamata is what you take to be true. Paramata is what you teach others for them to believe. Then a Buddha has no swamata. A Buddha doesn't believe anything because he knows that reality is not digital, no digital concept can correspond to reality, to even a small parcel of reality, to nothing, never. Then, whenever he talks, he's talking paramata. He's talking to make others believe something that leads them beyond belief. Yeah, he's using languages to go beyond language, words to go beyond words.
And so, is it possible in Western cultures or not?
Oh, yes.
But Mikhail says that it's impossible, absolutely. At least in the framework of humanitarian sciences and philosophy.
I don't say such a radical. Now, of course, everything is possible. Of course, on the margins of philosophy, there are many. Some philosophers were influenced by Buddhism, like Schopenhauer, yeah, like Nietzsche, like some other philosophers. There was some kind of influence, but I see a very big difference. Really, at the root of the Western tradition, the idea that the world is created, that somebody created this world. This is what Judaism believes, this is what Christianity believes, this is what Islam believes. Buddhism has quite other, the first statement of Buddhism is very much different. Nobody created the world. Nobody. So it's a big difference. Well, you should work with your mind. You should. There is no demiurge, the first one who made it all, and we are moving along the lines of creation. No, it's such a big difference. Mm-hmm. Hegel was a Christian philosopher in a Protestant tradition, and Prussian official philosopher. Who played because for Hegel, philosophy is born in ancient Greece. Everything which was before Greece is a kind of some kind of vague Eastern ideas, but it's not philosophy. Of course, he knew about something about India, a little bit about China, a couple of pages about Persia. But real philosophy is very, very, because in Greece there was democracy, there was elected ruler, there were citizens like Socrates, like who voted for. Of course, he knew that there was 100,000 slaves who did not participate in it. But it was the first democracy, and democracy has is origin of philosophy. And then in Rome, of course, the continuation of Greek tradition, then Christianity, and then, of course, the New Age. So he was a very Western philosopher. He said in India there was some interesting people, but not, it's not philosophy. It's some kind of Eastern religious, vague religious ideas, including Buddha. Mm-hmm.
One interesting thing is that in Greece, matter was eternal. Mm-hmm. In Greek philosophy in general, I mean, of course, Plato invented the demiurge, mm-hmm. But matter that was shaped by the demiurge was eternal. Mm-hmm. And but in that there was a connection because Greece and the East were not really so divorced originally. This divorce came after the Indo-European invasion. In Crete, for example, they had the Minoic religion.
Of course, yes. That's and why Hegel said that ancient Greek philosophy were like children. Uh-huh. The real philosophy starts with Christianity. Really adult philosophy and monotheism. So, he said Greeks were very nice and very aesthetically talented people, but children, it's like a kindergarten, Greece, yes? He loved Greece very much. Hegel was one of the best, he was educated, he knew ancient Greek language very well, and Greek culture, but he regarded them like small children that are not ripe for philosophy. But still, philosophy begins in Greece, of course. But it's a kind of the birth of philosophy, not a really adult mellow philosophy, which is in Germany. Then he said that Prussia is a kind of end of philosophy. His philosophy is the end of philosophy. So he wanted to be the last philosopher. Yeah. That's why. Well, but still, philosophy continues after Hegel, after his end of philosophy.
Yeah, it's clear and set perspective at the same time. And I want to put your attention again back to initial, not yet clarified question. Namely, is it possible to bring Dzogchen vision to Western culture, on Western language? Is it possible, what do you think, to correct, in a sense, Wilber mistakes in explaining Dzogchen perspective.
Definitely. Well, that's what I'm trying to do. Whether I am successful or not, it's not for me to decide, because then I would be like Hegel. It would be like what Chogyam Trungpa called the absolutely demonic state of total egohood. But that's what we are, I mean, I'm trying to do, and probably many other people are trying to do. And if I try to do it, because it's because I believe it's possible, certainly.
And if not to refer to Grove, Wilber, to other transpersonal stuff, what is the essence of your vision? Well, how we can do this, for example?
That is not very easy to explain.
I understand.
Because the true condition cannot be explained in words. That's what we were saying before.
Yes.
So if I say what is the essence of my vision, is going beyond words and beyond conditioning. But that's not only my vision. That's a very ancient vision that is shared by Buddhism, but it's not circumscribed to Buddhism. It's something that many traditions have shared. And then what is it that is characteristic of Dzogchen is also a method to achieve that, which is very appropriate for our time, I believe. And we could explain that in terms that are shared by the Hegel Marxist tradition.
Okay, for example?
To transform contradiction into conflict. The contradiction is ego. And why is it a contradiction? Because, first of all, ego is based on avidya, which is delusion. And delusion contradicts the true condition. But delusion also makes us contradict ourselves all the time, not only intellectually, but on a much deeper level. For example, this delusion makes us achieve the opposite of what we want to achieve through our actions. The whole project of modernity was to produce a technological paradise. And what have we achieved? Ecological crisis, which is threatening the very survival of humankind. And that is the absolute contradiction of the intentions at the root of that project. As laid out by René Descartes or by Francis Bacon, is the same project expressed in two different philosophical perspectives, but it's basically the same: to dominate nature, to submit it to the desires of man. But then we do that with the vision which the Buddha in the Udana of the Pali Canon and the Tathagatagarbha Sutra of the Mahayana Canon explained in terms of the parable of the man with the elephant. And there were all these blind men, and the king told them, please determine what is the object in front of you. And one put the hand on the eye and said, it's a bowl. And another one on the husk and said, we changed it a little bit so that it's more appropriate, a hook for carrying pieces of ice. And another one took the trunk and said it was a hose pipe, a fireman hose pipe. Well, and so on, everyone. And the last one got hold of the tail and then threw it away and tried to run away because it was a snake. So we try to take out, sever all the pieces of the elephant that we think might be useful to us to make life more comfortable, and to destroy all that we feel that threatens our existence. And by doing that, we have come to the point at which we are on the verge of self-destruction. And, for example, we come back to Wilber. Wilber is an evolutionist. He absolutely overlooks that, because that would destroy absolutely his whole theory of evolution. His own evolutionary outlook would be destroyed if faced with this reality. So he says, now we are still centuries far from the end of evolution. The time at which enlightenment will become available to everyone is centuries away. But we are not centuries away from self-destruction. It's something that is at the by the corner. I mean, so what Wilber is doing is telling us, go ahead to the abyss and fall down to the abyss, because after the abyss you are going to find general enlightenment. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So this is to me outrageous.
Mm. Of course, yeah. Yeah, perhaps the Sutra Buddhism has many more chances to get included in the Western system of education, to get influence. We have already some figures who influenced the Western, the Sutra Buddhist, like Suzuki, especially the non-gradual Sutra. I mean, Chan and Zen. Our teacher says, as he came to Naples, the Zen was already popular. Mm-hmm. Nobody knew about Dzogchen at this time. He was the first mm-hmm. one who actually started teaching Dzogchen. But Zen was already a set of a kind of war in the vogue, and Suzuki's books were read and taught at the universities. And so, but it's much easier to transmit the sutra tradition, because the teacher is a man. Buddha in sutra is a friend, more experienced friend who teaches. It's like a little bit like the Western University sutra. I mean, his teacher, he's a teacher. He's Ananda, then Maud Galyana, then Subhuti. He's surrounded by the first disciples, and they are a kind of he's a professor. They are a sort of aspiring professors, associate professors, and then assistant professors and some. So sutra is easier, much easier. So I guess, but Dzogchen is very difficult. Yeah, very difficult to understand, to explain, because you need an enlightened teacher. And our teacher repeats, don't try to teach to study Dzogchen by books. Don't try. Only in a very exceptional case, if you are 16th or 20th reincarnation, you are already prepared to take. So it may be very rare chance that you understand Dzogchen by a book, but in a usual way you need a teacher who has a teacher who belongs to this lineage of teachers, and that's why it's so difficult. It's so esoterical, and sutra is not esoterical. It's exoterical teaching. So they try to explain what it is all about. Vajrayana is very difficult to transplant in the Western world, and still more difficult Dzogchen. That's my limited way of seeing. Maybe I wish from my heart that Dzogchen expands. Of course, I would like Dzogchen expanding through the world. Of course, we read special verses at the end of the practice, wishing that the teaching of Dzogchen shines like sun and expands. We wish it all, but I see a lot of difficulties of this way. That's why any kind of missionary for Dzogchen is prohibited. you cannot say people study Dzogchen. It's the best way. Everybody should come himself. That's also a limitation, because our teacher says all people who came to me are people who decided to come. It's not I call them, come to me, I am the best teacher in the world. Leave Derrida, leave Deleuze, come to me. Everybody who came to him came by his own decision, very profound decision to change his life. That's why he has several thousand disciples, real disciples, but every disciple is a real disciple because it's his decision, it's not the teacher's decision. And Derrida has his school is many dozens of thousands of followers, direct disciples and then their disciples. So many, much more people follow deconstruction than Dzogchen. But difference is deconstruction can be preached from the university chair, and Dzogchen, everybody should. It's a decision of it's a profound decision of every single person. That's why it's not possible just to I come to my students and say, yes, when I was 54, I met enlightened teacher Nam Khai Norbu. Come to Nam Khai Norbu, you. I cannot say this. It's against the rule. It's against the rule. Like if, like Valodia, who is much older practitioner than I am, if somebody has this this aura of and you see that he and you want to be like him, so it may be a kind of introduction to the teaching. But I cannot give a lecture. How good is Dzogchen? How good every, because I know it's too profound. One cannot just preach it openly. Of course we would like to see this teaching as wide as possible, of course, but at the same time.
Elias, and what is your hopes to introduce Dzogchen vision to at least transpersonal field?
Well, first of all, I would like to say a couple of things, which is there is a prophecy according to which it is in our time that Dzogchen will spread as it never did before. Mm-hmm. And then, now my theory, why should that happen? Because for the first time, delusion shows itself to be delusion by the effects it's producing ecologically. And in general, yeah, how society is decomposing, is becoming... So the madness, I mean, there is this story in this book by Chandrakirti of the king who was told that the rain would fall over his kingdom, that would drive everyone crazy who drank from the waters that would be polluted by that rainfall. And then he built a big tank and he told to everyone to build a tank. When the people exhausted their reserves of water, they suddenly realized the king and the minister were crazy. And then the ministers exhausted their reserves, and then they realized the king was the only one who was crazy. And mm-hmm. They were going to impeach him, and then he had no other alternative but to drink the water. Mm-hmm. And then everyone was saying again, yeah? Mm-hmm. Because everyone was so absolutely crazy that everyone... and I think this is our condition, yeah? Mm-hmm. But this, in the past, wasn't evident. And now, because of ecological crisis and the state of decomposition of society and everything, is becoming evident. Mm-hmm. And that might be the driving force, yeah? But of course, it might be the driving force to become Mahayana Buddhist or Zen Buddhist or Sufis or Taoist or Shaivist or... Mm-hmm. Yeah? But why Dzogchen? Well, I cannot say why Dzogchen, but in our time, delusion is so strong that we need methods which are proportionally powerful. And Dzogchen is that method, because it's like ego grasping, delusion, yeah, our belief in the truth of things, which is here, yeah, anguish is that. Mm-hmm. Anguish is very strong belief in reality of things. Mm-hmm. Anguish in a general term, it could be angst also, mm-hmm. not necessarily l'angoisse de Satan. Because it's very strong belief in reality, yeah? And Dzogchen worked with that.
But Buddhist as such works with it. I mean, yeah, Sutra, but Sutra also works with it. Sutra is also saying that the world is an illusion.
Oh yes, yeah. But with using anguish. Dzogchen, the method of Dzogchen is based on anguish. Mm-hmm. And that's why the method of Dzogchen is to, as we said before, transform contradiction into conflict. Mm-hmm. Because if we are under delusion, that's a contradiction. Mm-hmm. When it becomes conflict, we cannot live in that delusion. Mm-hmm. And Dzogchen has methods like Togel, mm-hmm. in which you make some visions appear that as soon as you experience yourself as separate from them, mm-hmm. Something that is called the wrathful dynamics of the Dharma Tao, of the true condition, happens that will and dissolve. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you need to have a capacity of self-liberation before.
That is a problem. Togel is, here we have about 1,000 students, yes? But I'm sure that Togel would practice maybe a dozen, maybe it would be very, very big success if Togel would be practiced by a dozen. If our teacher is very cautious about this method, and he says, I should really see somebody is really prepared. It's not enough to be my disciple. I should see this should be a disciple who really, really deserve this method. I don't know how many people in Dzogchen community worldwide practice Togel. I'm not sure that.
But also Rinpoche said many times that to be realized, it's enough to practice Semde.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
To know the nature of mind. Yeah.
But many people want to realize this rainbow body. Many people, they have this ambition. They have want to realize the rainbow body. And without Togel, you cannot realize the rainbow body. They ask teacher, always, they insist, give us this teaching. Because then they say, it's egoistic, you are not giving us this teaching. And he says, it's not a problem of egoism, it's a problem you are not prepared.
Exactly.
If you are prepared, I would give everybody this teaching.
I would say that Semde can lead to realization. But in Semde, if you get distracted, there is nothing that will force you to liberate. So you can lose a long time in distraction. But with a practice like Togel, as soon as you get distracted, as soon as you fall into delusion, and liberate. So it's like a compelling dynamics.
Foda.
Huh?
Foda. For da, mm-hmm. practice.
Mm-hmm. For that practice.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yes, you are a very old practitioner, as I see, much, much older than I am. And you are also at the same time, like me, the teacher of philosophy. And my question is, these two lineages, you are the Dzogchen practitioner, you are the professor of philosophy. I understand what Dzogchen gave you as a teacher of philosophy, but it's very much more difficult to understand what philosophy gave you as far as Dzogchen practitioner. Dzogchen gives very personal. You feel the things lighter. You are more detached. Yeah, so Dzogchen gives you, whether you're a philosopher or you are a waitress or you are an engineer, it does not matter. Dzogchen gives every person who practices this receives a lot from Dzogchen. Say, if you teach philosophy, how philosophy has influenced your Dzogchen practice? That is for me a question.
Not at all. Mm-hmm. It's not influencing it.
That's why.
What it's doing, the importance is that if we have studied, for example, philosophy, mm-hmm. Then we are contaminated by that, we are conditioned by that. Mm-hmm. And then we need to counteract the wrong beliefs mm-hmm. of the philosophy that we have learned. Mm-hmm. And we can do that from the standpoint of Dzogchen, mm-hmm. but just to throw it away. Mm-hmm. Because we cannot throw it away before we have counteracted it, because it's like mm-hmm. something that is, yeah, thought, mm-hmm. stuck in us, mm-hmm. that we have to counteract it first and then throw it away. Mm-hmm. There is an explanation of kinds of faith mm-hmm. in Buddhism. The lowest kind of faith is because you are born in a country that follows this tradition, mm-hmm. X tradition. The second is because you get inspired by a painting or a master, that you see something in the master, or a sutra that someone was reading and something happened to you. Then the third is by understanding the point of view and trying to destroy it, like someone who is trying to see whether gold is true or false. When you realize that it cannot be destroyed, you get deeper faith. But the deepest faith is the one that comes from realization, mm-hmm. from the lived experience of the true condition. And if when these last two are like that, then you have unshakable faith.
Mm-hmm. So philosophy have not influenced your practice of Dzogchen. That's also a kind of proof that it's not symmetrical. And I mean, in Buddhism, of course, the most popular Buddhism is teachings like Pure Land of Amitāya. They have now a big number of followers. Say, non-gradual sutra is much more esoterical. It's really not easy to follow this way. You need special capacities. Tantra is very esoterical, of course, and it's not by chance that most of Dzogchen practitioners in Tibet were Vajrayana practitioners who realized
Mahamudra.
They came to Dzogchen through Vajrayana. Yeah. Almost every Tibetan Dzogchen practitioner started as Vajrayana practitioner. That's why our teacher is revolutionary in a way that he is teaching Dzogchen in the Western context without Tantra. It's a revolution, because usually Longchen Pa will follow Tantra, and then he understood that the essence of Tantra is Ati Yoga. But he is teaching Dzogchen without this without Tantra. It's quite new, I guess. And I don't know who else is teaching in the West this way. The direct introduction into Dzogchen without Tantra, without this, he says it's very difficult to imitate these rituals, because he says if I want to make Kalachakra, I need a week just to prepare this. It's in the West, he says it's impossible. It's but this Pure Land of Amitāya, you need just imagine your future. You just imagine this golden palace, this statue. It's not so difficult, yes. But non-gradual sutra, it's already difficult. You should really show your teacher that you realize Kuan. Yeah. You need to solve this. Somebody are not capable of solving this. They want, but they do not succeed. Yeah. So And Vajrayana is for very, very talented people who really have this capacity.
In time. Mm-hmm. Because in Vajrayana you have to develop a visualization mm-hmm. that you to really, and then the completion or perfection stage mm-hmm. to do those two things. Ideal is to make to do a 9 years, 9 months, and 9 days retreat, mm-hmm. or 7, 7, 7, or at least 3, 3, 3, and that is not very. And it might happen mm-hmm. that you do 9, 9, 9, and still you need another one. So, and maybe you never reach the end.
Alice, may I summarize your criticism about Ken Wilber? Uh-huh. You think, or you see Wilber as mainly based on Hegel's gradual perspective.
Yes.
And Wilber at the same time pretend that he's presenting Dzogchen vision, uh-huh. and it's completely different stuff. Exactly. Hegel and Dzogchen, gradual and non-gradual path.
And constructing and destructing.
Yeah, constructing and extending and ascending yeah. perspective vision. Yeah. So am I right?
Yes.
And so let's go now to another famous transpersonal visionary and theoretician, Stanislav Grof.
Okay.
And the last volume of your Beyond the Mind papers is completely, almost completely dedicated to Stan Grof and two of his followers, actually. And so can we go to Stan Grof, to your vision of Stan Grof ideas?
Yes.
What is your criticism about him? Main criticism.
Okay, I feel much nearer Grof than Wilber mm-hmm. because it's a descending path. Mm-hmm. It's not an ascending path. Mm-hmm. So this is much nearer to the way I understand spirituality. Mm-hmm. But there is something that I think, I don't know if to call it an error or something that I don't agree definitively and which is common to all transpersonal psychologists and philosophers, is that there is an incapacity and an inability to distinguish what is essential for me to distinguish, which is nirvana. I mean, what is nirvana? What is samsara, active samsara, and what is seed condition samsara?
I think according to Grof, nirvana is holotropic, samsara is heliotropic, and seeds of samsara is three main passions, something like that.
Yeah,
but, roughly speaking.
Yeah, but the thing is, it doesn't correspond to what in Dzogchen or in Mahayana Buddhism is any of these things.
Maybe.
For example, he has this idea of this idea of coex or coex, mm-hmm, how mm-hmm. you pronounce it?
System of condensed experiences.
Yes. Coex?
Yeah, coex.
Okay. I think this is a very interesting idea. And when among all these coex, he has this perinatal mm-hmm. matrices. Mm-hmm. Matrices. And that are matrix 1, matrix 2, matrix 3, and matrix mm-hmm. 4. Mm-hmm. And then in matrix 1 and 4, you have different kinds. Yeah, some that he deems positive and some that he deems negative. Mm-hmm. And 2 and 3 are always negative. Mm-hmm. Well, to begin with, this idea that there are some matrices which are positive and some which are negative, I don't agree because a positive matrix is pleasant, so you cling to it. So it can turn into the arupa lokas, the formless realms, which is what the teachers of the Buddha Shakyamuni were able to attain, and he left them because he realized that there was no realization on that. Yeah? For example, in perinatal matrix one, when that matrix is positive, then you have a feeling of union with everything. And that might either be an arupa loka, a formless realm, or it could be a state which the Dzogchen teachings call kunji, then, or kunji lungmaten, the neutral base of all. Mm. And that is a state which technically belongs to samsara. Why? Because in Dzogchen we have four types of avidya. I use the Sanskrit or marikpa in Tibetan because it means unawareness or ignorance. That's the first type of avidya. But the other ones are delusion. So again, we have terminological problem. If we render it etymologically as unawareness or ignorance, we are obviating the fact that it involves delusion. Yeah? The first type is just unawareness of our own true condition. Why? Mm-hmm. Because of a factor of a stupefaction called Mongcha in Tibetan, which has always been going along the stream of mind of sentient beings and has always been preventing the recognition of the true condition. A stupefaction is something that doesn't allow you to understand or to perceive clearly. Like, for example, opium is a stupefying agent. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or if I go, yeah, and you get frightened, yeah. Mm-hmm, also, mm-hmm. You don't understand mm-hmm. what's going on. You get absolutely confused for a moment. And that has been going with the stream of mind of sentient beings since beginning less samsara. And the Buddha was in that state before coming to Buddhahood. He was in a very deep samadhi where there was no realization of the true condition. There was no subject and object duality. There was no perception in terms of concepts. It seemed something that could be very similar to the definition of enlightenment. But he was enlightened out of that, because mm-hmm. when luminosity is shown, that is when perception arose from that state, he recognized it non-dually rather than perceiving it as something external. If he had perceived that as something external, then that would have been the second type of avidya, the subject-object duality, which is by giving the illusion of reality to a super subtle concept that is called Trimandala in Sanskrit and Korsum in Tibetan. It produces this object duality. And then there is a third type of avidya, which is taking us through this concept that Descartes called intuitive and also Locke called intuitive. And Acharya Dignaga called them Artha Samanya. Dönchi in Tibetan. If, for example, I see the door and I know it's a door, even if I am not thinking in terms of discursive thought, this is a door. I see it and I know it's a door. Yeah? And then that is because of the illusion of plurality, of a reality made out of countless substances. Yeah? This figure ground mind is always taking something as figure and leaving the rest as ground, and that figure is understood in terms of a subtle concept, and then we believe the concept is the figure. The figure mm-hmm, is mm-hmm. the concept, and that's all that is delusion. Yeah. So in Kunshi, we have only the first type of unawareness. The first type mm-hmm. of avidya, which is unawareness, which is because of the factor of stupefaction. And that is a transpersonal condition. None of these transpersonal people distinguish the different types of transpersonal conditions. That may basis of error for me. Then there are the actively samsaric transpersonal conditions, which are altogether different. When you take this kunji as object, a subject arises and you perceive this infinity or infinitude as object, and you feel you are that infinity, you feel proud. That is the highest realms of the gods, which is a psychological way of speaking in terms of the symbology of ancient India, but also of Greece. Yeah, an Indo-European general view somehow. You are totally under delusion, and this is the worst delusion, because you are totally under delusion and you believe that you have gone beyond delusion. And then you are very proud because you think you attained enlightenment, and what you have attained is, to use again that word by Chogyam Trungpa, the totally demonic state of complete egohood. Yeah? And that difference is not made either by the descenders or by the ascenders. Then you believe, for example, that a positive prenatal matrix, one,
is please something... Continue, I change battery. Continue.
Okay. Then I go to take a pee.
Yes, okay.
Yeah, so we were saying that... for example, he takes a positive picture of a positive perinatal matrix one and a negative one, which may be the feeling of being poisoned or of paranoia or etc. And what he sees as a good one is the bad one for me. Because you can be stuck in that like a bee in honey, like a fly in honey, yeah? A fly goes to take honey, yeah, and gets stuck in it. And in the what he sees as a bad perinatal matrix is the one in which contradiction has turned into conflict. And that is the driving force for liberation, yeah? Then you cannot stay under delusion. Then the contradiction, the anguish, the bad feeling is so strong that you have to apply the Dzogchen instruction for delusion to self-liberate. And I think that this methodology of Dzogchen can be explained in terms of the Divine Comedy. Yeah, and actually not, yeah. It corresponds very closely to some explanations in Dzogchen. They don't explain about the hells and purgatory and so on, but the stages correspond quite precisely. And the methodology consists in to put you in an, what Ronald Lang would call an untenable position, a position in which you cannot stay, but you cannot leave. Yeah? And then contradiction be turned into conflict, and either conflict together with contradiction, which is delusion, self-liberate, or you disintegrate and have a psychosis. The only way you can have the guarantee that you will not have a psychosis is if you have developed a capacity of self-liberation before with the practice of texture. Which is a previous practice in which every time a thought arises, you look at its nature. You have already been introduced to the nature of mind, which means that you have had to rigpa. It means you have had an experience. I don't like the word, the etymology of the word experience, but in order not to complicate things, an experience or a direct realization of the true condition of yourself and the whole of reality beyond concept and beyond duality. Therefore, Once you don't remain in doubt because you have been back to that condition again and again, then you can continue in the state with this practice of texture, which is each time a thought arises and confuses you, you believe in this thought, you look at the thought, and because the nature of mind, the true condition of mind is the Dharmakaya, and that is all liberating gnosis, as soon as the Dharmakaya manifests the duality of subject and object, and the thought disappears, instantly dissolves. When you have developed that capacity to a certain extent, then when you are put in this untenable position, that is the way to exhaust samsara fast track. So, this idea that there are good perinatal matrices and bad perinatal matrices, to me, of course, what you want to do is just to help people live better in duality, then it's not so bad. That's why I like Grof better than Wilber.
As far as I understand Grof, the whole idea of perinatal matrices came from his experience that there are very deep level of conditioning of us as human being. Yeah. Before official biography, before birth, this was an attempt to find what this determinants can be and what where they can be founded on some perinatal level. Of course, he wasn't analytical like you in the concept of perinatal programming, so to say. They are very vague. But the idea to look deeper than academic psychology is quite productive, I think. And so Grof wasn't able to prove the existence, I'm sure, of basic perinatal matrices, even from his observation from LSD psychotherapy. It's not enough. It's only one source, so to say, to be a science, yeah, to be scientific proof. But as a visionary, I think he's pointing to right direction, at least, to Western, and also not only perinatal, but also transpersonal realms, mm-hmm, since it's two realms overcoming biographical.
Yeah.
And I see Grof as the first Western psychologist who actually were trying to prove shunyata. Since according to Grof, any human being can have any experience. And so the only difference between you and Christ and Misha and Buddha is that, for example, we are ordinary human beings and we are limited by our circumstances and experiences. But Buddha and Christ, hopefully, are not limited. They are enlightened. So they are living in infinite dimensions. And so Grof proved that every human being can have any vision, so we are not limited, and our true nature is infinite. And it's the revelation of great spiritual traditions.
Yeah.
And so he was first scientist who actually, from Western medicine, psychiatric and psychological experience, proved this vision. I think this is great achievement. And this is what drives most of Grof's followers, including me. I was also very much a Grof follower. I studied with him holotropic breathwork and published a lot of his books. I see him as a great scientist, great visionary, and great psychologist, of course. Great organizers, since he organized the International Transpersonal Association and many conferences, and you know that next will be in Prague this year. And so, but of course, he's also he has his own limitation.
Of course.
And one limitation I see is his reduction of everything to holotropic perspective.
Yes.
Holotropic breathwork, holotropic paradigm. Everything is moving towards wholeness, from particular limited to wholeness, which is holotropic and unlimited. And but if we look at human history, human culture, human spiritual tradition, moving from part to whole is only one perspectives, and there is also another universal perspectives, metamorphosis, transfiguration, transformation, alchemy in Western cultures, yeah. Tantra in Eastern cultures. So yeah. It's purification from unclear to clear. And there is no one words, no one idea about moving from path to wholeness in this perspective. It's completely another perspective. There is also another perspective, waking up. Is it about moving towards wholeness? No. It's another story. Another technologies or enlightenment. It's also about ascending light, for example. Light of true knowledge. Light of certainty. Light of wisdom. It's so growth perspective, growth attempt to reduce everything, all richness to one particular most true perspective. Holotropic is wrong, I think. Also, his attempt to describe the process of self-healing, which happens in holotropic states, in psychedelics, spontaneous healing, spontaneous self-liberation, to the whole called mechanism of inner healer. In the healer in holotropic breathwork, famous statement. It's a right direction, but wrong and not modern idea in our time. Of course, all great spiritual traditions advise us to believe in higher. To trust, to God, to rely on Tao, for example. Mm-hmm. And we know that Freud were following dreams, and first version of deep psychology manifested from this following. Jung, after breaking with Freud, follow unconsciousness and analytical psychology. So it's a right direction. But what is wrong perspective? Since I am sure, first of all, the figure of inner healer is very suspicious. It's too anthropomorphic.
Yeah.
And it has too much relation with monotheistic Western ideas of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. One God, one man. So it's this formula is...
And
it's not enough.
It's very much similar to, you know, Maria Sabina.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
She didn't have teachers, she didn't have any tradition, only the mushrooms were her gurus.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the same, yeah. The mushrooms were the catalyzer for the inner healer.
This idea. And also, you know, many years ago, I started to ask myself about the essence of psychotherapy. I asked, the question was, what was psychotherapy before psychotherapy, which means before Freud and Breuer, before the end of 19th century, and how for the thousands of years people came to goodness, became happy, and became healed from psychological problem. So this brought me to the idea of the practices of the care of the soul. And if you look into European history, the beginning of this caring of the soul happened in ancient Greek. For example, Foucault, in his books, describes the history of European subject, and it's very much connected with the tradition of care of the soul.
Yeah.
And so, finally, I found the 12 basic fundamental practices of the care of the soul, general to all world cultures.
Uh-huh.
And now I can say that what Groff's name, Vague, Inner Healer, beyond words, beyond any attempts to define, is actually different sets of practices of the care of the soul, which were transmitted in the human history for the only reason, and the reason is that they are effective. They are not proving some names, not getting money like modern psychotherapy. So I named this practice primordial psychotherapy, and I described them in papers, in presentation, in book. And so, and the difference between my idea of primordial psychotherapy, 12 methods of primordial psychotherapy, and Groff's idea of Inner Healer is that in Inner Healer you had to trust. No other relation between you and Inner Healer. And Inner Healer is beyond words. So, if, for example, you're a businessman, politician, rational man, and you go to a teacher of holotropic breathwork, and you get feedback, just trust your Inner Healer. But who is Inner Healer? It's beyond words. You can explain. But I can explain, and I can teach how primordial psychotherapy happens. And 90% of what is happening during sessions of holotropic breathwork and in psychotherapy can be understood through these 12 methods of 12 ways of primordial psychotherapy. And the difference between me and Groff is that people who study primordial psychotherapy can rely, can be sure in the mechanism of healing. But followers of Groff can only trust. Blind belief. And knowledge and assurance based, certainty based on knowledge, on experience. For me, it's a big difference, for example. Very, very big difference. Also, Groff's ideas of holotropics is very vague. His distinction between holotropic and helotropic, for me, it's too naive. And he doesn't study the old European tradition of philosophy of unity. For example, in Millet school of we know a lot of names. Who was the first who teach about unity, undivided?
So the first one was Falaise.
From
Millet.
From Millet, and then many names, many. So it's long tradition. And in Russia we have the philosophy of all unity also. Mm-hmm. There is Advaita, there is Dogchen, non-gradual and non-dual tradition. There is some modern tradition like Advaita, Integral Advaita by Sri Aurobindo. Groff doesn't refer to anything. He just has a statement, holotropic, helotropic, that's all.
And even the term helotropic means turning to matter, but matter in Greek philosophy was always the undifferentiated. It was that which is not divided. Exactly what I was saying, that is the analog, the continuous, which is distorted by conceptual perception. Well, not all Greek philosophers agree that it's distorted, but in the way I was explaining, it is distorted when we perceive it in terms of plurality. So the term helotropic doesn't make sense. It's not the contrary of holotropic, because Hyle or Hyle is holo.
But I think that if we go beyond these arguments, beyond these critics, Grof anyway is a great visionary and great scientist, and he was able to introduce a lot of really new ideas to modern philosophy and to put our attention on idea of the roots of politics, psychohistory, for example, and modern problems, global problems, and also his idea of spiritual emergency, which was also adopted by into a framework of official psychiatry, is also, I think, it's very, very, very useful and innovative. And his ideas about cosmic game is not elaborated enough, actually. Kind of bringing ideas of Indian philosophy into the framework of modern consciousness research. But it's good attempt anyway.
And he has one good thing, that is comparing the current world situation with a perinatal matrix 3, mm-hmm. when it's about to turn to a matrix 4.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is very good. I completely agree with that. This is also part of my philosophy of history. But I think that for that to happen, it has to be informed by wisdom. Mm-hmm. And it has to be in reference to a tradition. I mean, we need transmission.
Sure. And also, I think that his studies about death is great. Also, based on his experience with helping of terminal patients, this is great. He can do some little mistakes in his interpretation of Barda Teodol, Egyptian Book of Death, etc., etc. But the vision and the very attempt is, of course, a great achievement. Mm-hmm. And also, I see that in big picture, his accent and his dedication to the study of non-ordinary states of consciousness mm-hmm. Was very challenging and very useful for modern Western psychology and humanitarian culture at all.
Well,
you should mention Mendel.
Uh-huh. No, we are talking about Grof now.
You know, we should mention
Arnold Mendel.
Let's now focus on Grof. Yeah, since it was Grof who actually dedicated 60 years of his life to the study of non-ordinary states first of all.
But I just wanted to say, also, we shouldn't forget Gregory Bateson, Ronald Langer.
John
Weir.
There is a big tradition, of course.
In Poland, I mean, there are...
It's a field, of course.
A field. There are many people who have been collaborating on that to develop that. And they, I think, informed each other. We cannot reduce them to one big figure.
Of course.
I, for example, was more influenced by Ronald Lang and David Cooper, even though David Cooper there are some ideas which are a little... the madness revolution was absolutely utopic. It was absolutely unrealizable. But the ideas were very interesting. Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the death of the family, but for me, it's a very important book also. Also, it's incomplete. Also, it needs to be informed by a tradition.
Mm-hmm.
But really, there are very important things in there. So I think
there is
a whole movement that we cannot reduce to one person.
Yeah, sure. You've done a great tour de force, completing and publishing these four books, Beyond Mind Papers. So what next?
Now I am working in... I have worked on other things which are perhaps less known, because there is this book on alienation, and there is Alienation, but mm-hmm. it's in Spanish. Mm-hmm. And that's a big mm-hmm. handicap because in Spanish, and also the problem is to publish. Yeah, this is mm-hmm. a big, this has been for me the main problem. Yeah, and there is another one which is a bit well known, but they made a 3,000 books edition and it got exhausted years ago, and I have never made a second edition to actualize it, to update it mm-hmm. Because of lack of time. And so it's now in internet. It's, those are more on philosophy of history and political philosophy, which I think is an important thing, because without spiritual transformation, you gave the name to the Congress, to the conference you organized in Russia in 2000 and something.
2018. Tools for Revolution.
Huh?
I am organizing in 2018 in St. Petersburg, Eurotas conference, uh-huh. Tools for Evolution.
Oh, but before you had one called Consciousness Revolution.
Yeah.
And I think without consciousness revolution, any kind of social change and political change and economical change is doomed. Because the same structure, hierarchical, oppressive, exploitative, and so on, will be reproduced because the mind is structured that way. But on the other hand, if we don't change the external at the same time, then the world destroys itself. So I think there has to be an interconnected a multidimensional, internal, external, spiritual, psychological, political, social, economical transformation if humankind is going to enter what promises to be the next stage, which would be this perinatal matrix 4, but understood as the result of not merely a death and rebirth experience, but informed by tradition, with the methods of tradition, a real change of consciousness that would somehow really spread the, what we could say, the enlightenment, the awakening of Buddhism, and make it something easily available for the whole of humankind. Mm-hmm. And I think that would be the natural next stage of evolution. And I see that the alternatives are self-destruction and that. And we don't know which one is going to be the outcome. But there is something very interesting by Bateson, Gregory Bateson. Mm-hmm. That's why I think many people have very important things to say. He realized, for example, that Freud developed the concept of thanatos in the in the context of his study of the neurosis of repetition, of the it was something that drove people to seek repeated experience of that which is painful, and then he inferred, but already Jung had also this idea before, that it was an attempt at self-healing somehow. And only the thanatos would be that which would be the healer ultimately, because it would be that which would allow for, make the reductio ad absurdum of delusion possible. And why do I mean by reductio ad absurdum of delusion? To show that delusion doesn't work. Now we are seeing it in ecological crisis, but also each one has to see it in his own experience, and that's what I call transforming contradiction into conflict by following the Hegelian Marxist tradition, yeah? This transformation of contradiction into conflict would be exactly that which would catalyze and make this transition to the next evolutionary stage possible. And that is the methodology of Dzogchen, and that's the role I attribute to the Dzogchen tradition, because it's the one that uses that method. And therefore it's the one that its very methodology corresponds to what is happening on a worldwide scale right now.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So we are praying, for example, in Sati Mahasanta, let's Dzogchen teaching will be available for everybody and will help every human being. Yeah, so as Dzogchen practitioners, we anyway engage in this process, to support everything. We are not missionaries, we are not propagating Dzogchen, but we are doing, at least in our personal dimension, something, and when it's possible, we are sharing with people if something can be useful for others.
And even though Rinpoche is never saying that we should go and preach and make a lot of advertising or propaganda or something like that, he's written many books and he's having webcasts which are worldwide, so he's making the tradition available.
Yeah.
And what I'm trying to do in my level of doing this intellectual thing is another way of doing the same. So I don't think there is a problem with making the tradition available. On the contrary, without becoming missionaries of Dzogchen,
mm-hmm.
we can make that tradition available,
mm-hmm.
because in my view is that which could catalyze the transition that would not only permit the continuity of our species, but even its transition to its next evolutionary stage.
Mm-hmm. Now I want Mikhail, do you want to conclude, to add something?
Yes.
So, Mikhail, do you want
to conclude? To ask something about Castaneda.
Later. No. Let's to complete this part of our conversation.
Yeah,
to summarize.
For me, the puzzle remains. So, how to transplant Dzogchen into a Western system of education and publishing, I see a lot of problems.
You've said that for philosopher, Dzogchen can be very, very useful, but not vice versa.
Well,
so
that's what Elias agreed.
Dzogchen philosophy has nothing to do with philosophy, in a sense.
No, I don't say nothing. I say that it's... It entails a lot of work to make these two systems come nearer. I don't see these possibilities right now. Nothing is excluded in the future.
Mm-hmm.
Everything can change. So
mm-hmm.
I don't want a final point. I'm just sure that it will go this way.
Mm-hmm.
The more problems Europeans will face, the more desire will be to go beyond.
Mm-hmm.
And this go beyond, this is one of the most important possibilities of this go beyond is Dzogchen.
Mm-hmm.
So our teacher says when he started teaching Dzogchen, nobody knew about Dzogchen, even the word Dzogchen was a kind of, they say it is Zen. He said, no, it is not Zen, it's
mm-hmm.
another system, it's self-perfection, it's not sutra teaching. Now we have 1,000 people who not only know what is the word Dzogchen, but practice Dzogchen at some level.
Mm-hmm.
So we see these changes. It's only 30 years, I guess. He started teaching in the late 70s, I guess. And now we have dozens of thousands of people who are already.
Recently, in Dzamlingar, there was a celebration of 40 years of Rinpoche teaching, just now.
You see, 40 years. Mm-hmm. And how many communities all over the world. So we see that this interest will rise, but we cannot influence it and say, tomorrow 1 million. Well, after tomorrow, 2 million, this is not possible.
Let's invite Rinpoche to biggest Olympic stadium of the world for 100,000 people to give a teaching. Yes! So it's not that stuff.
Well, there is a lot of him on YouTube. All over the world, people can follow at least an exoteric part of his teaching. Mm-hmm. So. I guess it will. The interest will grow.
And a lot of general books about by him about Dzogchen also, yeah.
But so I'm optimistic.
Okay, great. Me too. And my position is that being Dzogchen practitioner and being philosopher, psychologist, engineer, we have the same primordial state. The same. So we are in the center of all our manifestations as philosopher or as Dzogchen practitioners, or as men, women, and people of different nations and occupations. So why not to manifest this primordial state in any type of activity we are doing?
Yeah.
And what is the possible manifestation, for example, in the framework of different types, different philosophers. Mm-hmm. I think it's possible to find some appropriate solutions.
What I told you that about Baudrillard, I knew him relatively well, and it was amazing. He had some capacity of the Buddhist kind. Mm-hmm. I am not sure that he knew much about Buddhism, but in my communication to him, I have always seen that he is a sort of distanced. Now the career does not interest him. Mm-hmm. The career does not interest him much, and he was very relaxed. And as I came to him in Paris, he said, "Let's drink a glass of whiskey to start the conversation." He was very. Uh-huh. So, because most of philosophers are career-oriented people, they are very much worried about the influence, about the books. But Baudrillard was a little bit different. He was really relaxed as far as his career. I never asked him whether he practiced something. I never asked him this. Mm-hmm. But I felt that he is a kind of kindred spirit. Mm-hmm. I always felt him like this. So it may be many people have this capacity, this potentiality. Even great philosophers sometimes.
Okay. Thank you very much, guys, for this very, very inspiring and fruitful conversation. Thank you.
Thanks to you for making it possible.
Yeah.
About Castaneda.
And let's now go to Carlos Castaneda.
Okay, I forgot to say something. I didn't advertise something because you asked me what are you working in, and I went to the political scene. Mm-hmm. No, but what I'm writing now are books on Dzogchen. I just put one on my web page, which is called Buddhism and Dzogchen Volume 1.
Oh, send us a link, please.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think you have it, but anyhow, I will send it. And I just gave you a short, in this thing, a short, like, Dzogchen instruction. Do you know the source of danger is fear?
Thirst of
the source of danger is fear.
source of dangerous fear.
I never gave you that book?
No, no.
Then I'll give it to you. Mm-hmm. Because I have here, I have copy. Did I give you the Cremation Ground poem book?
Mm.
No?
No.
I give you. Okay. So that's what I'm doing now. I'm doing. Mm-hmm. I'm writing purely Thoughtian books now.
Are you retired already, or are you retired, or still teaching?
No, I retired. So now I will concentrate on that.
Good.
Let's go to Castañeda. Sorry, but I wanted to use that for advertising.
Sure.
Which are freely available
Mikhail,
on the web. Yeah?
Come to join us. Come and join us. So let's now go to Carlos Castaneda, who is very contradictional writer, a hero for millions of people, who inspired them to start their own spiritual quest, and also, nevertheless, there is a lot of discussion about the honesty of his books, his stories about Don Juan, who is a kind of archetypal teacher, and also his attempt to present a shaman like a great enlightened spiritual teacher. So, as a native Spanish-speaking human being, you probably have more knowledge and more connection to Castaneda world. So let's talk about Castaneda. What was your first encounter with his books, and maybe with himself or with some of his friends?
I think it was in, his books, of course. It wasn't in Latin America. I think I read them in Sweden. Yeah. But anyhow, however it is, the first book I didn't like. It looked strange to me.
The teaching of Don Juan, yeah?
Yeah.
A kind of to present academic version.
But then Journey to Iceland.
Journey to Iceland, the third one.
He spoke about the way of the witch and the way of the ordinary person.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, who is, and that the purpose of Don Juan's teaching was to make people fall in between those two realities, which neither of them is true. And that is a Buddhist idea, of course. I mean, not Buddhist, but in agreement with Buddhism.
Mm-hmm.
But then I don't think that, I've been going to Mexico a lot.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I know people who were they knew Castañeda.
So you've met people who knew Castaneda.
And the people who also have theories about what Castaneda was,
mm-hmm.
because of some research that has been going there.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems that all of them agree that everything is a big invention.
Mm. Mm.
Another disagreement, because it has to do with that, I have with Groff, is that he... the shamanic falls within the transpersonal. The transpersonal is somehow the good thing. Somehow, of course, he says realization is not. I mean, the final result of the path, so to say, is not totally holotropic, not totally holistic, but it's like the post-meditation state in Buddhism, when you are not yet a Buddha, but you can have access to the holistic state. And then when you are not in those states, you don't take reality to be so true. And that is not the final state of Buddhism, but it agrees very much with this Castañeda idea. And there is a book of mine called Chamanismo y Dzogchen, which has been published in Spain. Right now, it's in your
book.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And I say that shamanism, For example, according to Michael Harner and many researchers that he has worked with, especially because Siberian shamanism is another thing. I don't know about that. Yeah? A disciple of Shenrab Miwoche or a disciple of Fei disciple of Shenrab Miwoche went to Siberia and brought this Dzogchen teaching. So perhaps there was Dzogchen in Siberian shamanism, I don't know. Yeah? Mm-hmm. And maybe that has been watered down and maybe that has been lost, or there isn't one practice in it but it's not widely known. So I won't touch on that because we don't know. Yeah, yeah? Yeah. But South American shamanism is the everyday reality is illusory. And the reality that people get in touch with by shamanic means is the true reality. In Dzogchen, the point is more in agreement with this Castañeda idea, yeah, to get free from both realities. Mm-hmm. So, for example, in the practice of Chert, just as in South American shamanism, you get all the demons come to you and you see them, yeah? But the purpose of the practice is not either to manipulate them to do black magic or to heal, or to allow them to manipulate in you by making them live in your chest, as mm-hmm. for example, Yanomami shamanism does. Mm-hmm. So that's a kind of bondage also. The purpose is that when you get in a state of absolute terror, you have turned contradiction into conflict. Mm-hmm. And then at that mm-hmm. point, you look at the mind in a certain way, and duality dissolves and the demons dissolve. And then you get free from that reality, but also from this one. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that I call meta-shamanism. Mm-hmm. I mean, because it uses a methodology which is analogous to shamanism, mm-hmm. but the purpose is quite the opposite. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if the Siberian shamans had that. This is beyond my knowledge. But in any case, in Bön, there was also that. Mm-hmm. So Bön is shamanic and meta-shamanic. It's shamanic with a meta-shamanic path, which yeah, is yeah. Bön Dzogchen. Now, Castañeda, we don't know. Some people are saying that actually he was a disciple of Aleister Crowley. Hmm. This is the...
This tradition, in a sense, yeah. yeah. Mm-hmm.
There is the guy who leads the Tibet House in Mexico City was very close friend with Castañeda. Ah. So also it's possible that Castañeda drew a lot from this friend mm-hmm. and he concocted all that teaching on the basis of some Tibetan teaching. So how can we know, yeah?
Probably he integrated a lot of books, a lot of influences, yeah, into a very inspiring novels, yeah?
And also there is a story that when Castañeda died, many of his disciples were going to kill themselves. I don't know if that is true, but it comes from people who knew these people.
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Neither do I.
What do you think about Castañeda?
But I, yeah. Good storyteller. mm-hmm. What else?
From the point of maybe philosophy, Dzogchen.
A couple of his books. It's a very interesting reading. I mean, mm-hmm. just start reading and it's... It's really intriguing what how he writes. Mm-hmm. Maybe for if I would be a shaman, I would be much more critical about what he writes. Mm-hmm. But as a reader, I appreciate the quality of literature that he mm-hmm. makes. Mm-hmm. He makes a good literature.
Mm-hmm. Good
storyteller. You told me that he was a very good. In Spanish poetry.
Yeah, yeah.
He
knew best of lyrical Spanish language poetry by heart.
Oh.
Yeah, yeah.
How do you know that?
I've read a lot about him.
Even I know something of Spanish poetry.
García Lorca, yeah?
Same, yes.
Can you repeat some verse by García Lorca?
I can try. Well, what's...
Michael can speak many languages, including Spanish also.
No duerme nadie por el mundo, nadie, nadie, no duerme nadie. Caballos vivirán en las tabernas y las hormigas furiosas atacarán los cielos amarillos que se refugian en los ojos de las vacas. Por las gradas sube Ignacio con toda su muerte a cuestas. Buscaba el amanecer no era. Busca su perfil seguro, el sueño lo desorienta. Buscaba su hermoso cuerpo, encontró su sangre abierta. No me digáis que la vea, yo no quiero ver el chorro cada vez con menos fuerza. Ese chorro que ilumina la extendida. Does it sound Spanish? Or?
You can speak him Spanish,
yeah. I didn't know you knew Spanish.
Well, I know, I was very much inspired by Lorca. I really liked him, really. He's a very great poet.
Yeah.
That's why I started studying Spanish, because of Lorca. And then I read some of his.